Mr. President, today we'll confirm two more appellate judges, bringing our total to 26 since the Trump administration began. This has been one of the hallmarks of the president's and our agenda, and it's critically important. So I want to thank the president, as well as all of our colleagues who have worked so hard to fill these vacancies on our nation's courts. There have been many accomplishments this last year and a half, but perhaps the greatest has been the new energized state of our economy. This is a direct, tangible impact on the quality of life of all Americans. The Declaration of Independence designates as among the unalienable rights the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I like to think that by getting our foot off the neck of the economy, by repealing unnecessary overregulation, and by cutting taxes and letting people keep more of what they earn, that we are pursuing those unalienable rights on behalf of the American people, certainly the pursuit of happiness. The Labor Department reported earlier this month that unemployment has fallen to 3.9% in July, which is close to the 18-year low that was achieved in May this year. One of the highlights of the jobs report was that high school dropouts and others who have struggled during the Obama-era recession are doing significantly better. Their unemployment rate fell to 5.1%, the lowest since the government started collecting data on those without a high school diploma. Of course, this points out, particularly at a time where labor is in short supply, that is, there are a lot of good-paying jobs for which there are not trained workers who can qualify for those jobs. It, I think, makes it incumbent on us at all levels of government, federal, state, and local, to do more to help train workers so they qualify for these good, well-paying jobs that right now are going unfilled because of a shortage of trained workers. So that's one of the imperatives, I believe, of a tight job market caused by a booming economy. The July report showed that the economy grew by 4.1% in the second quarter. That's an incredible number. The economy is literally on fire. And that's a good thing for the American people. All of this positive economic news is complemented by the tax reform package I mentioned a moment ago that we passed last December, which has become perhaps the biggest game changer of all, opening doors and offering new opportunities for American workers. In order to make the rates of taxation in America competitive globally, we lowered the corporate rate from 35% to 21%. This is something that Democrats like President Obama, as well as Republicans, have supported in the past because recognizing that we were chasing investment overseas and any earnings on investments overseas were not coming back to the United States to be invested here in workers and infrastructure, this was a self-inflicted wound, which we have now cured. We also were successful in helping working families by doubling the child tax credit. One of the tangible benefits of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act is that more than 700 companies have used the tax savings to benefit their employees as well as their customers. They've announced pay raises, 401k retirement match increases, utility bills have been cut for seniors and those on fixed incomes because investor-owned utilities, when they got their tax rate lowered, that meant that they had to lower rates that they charge on utility bills. And this legislation has resulted in bonuses and other benefits for American workers, perhaps too numerous to mention. But it is worth mentioning because, unfortunately, in the fog that represents the news coverage that comes out of Washington, D.C., sometimes these tangible benefits are overlooked. And it's important for us to demonstrate that we are keeping faith with the American people, the people who sent us here, and we're doing the work of governing in a way that directly and tangibly benefits each of them. Something, again, that gets lost in the fog that emanates here from Washington. But it's not just the economy that deserves mention. The judiciary is the a third and co-equal branch of government. I believe that the confirmation of federal judges is one of the most important things that we do here in the United States Senate. It's not something that the House of Representatives has any role in. Under the Constitution, it is our responsibility to provide advice and consent on federal judges. And who gets selected as a federal judge, I believe, was one of the reasons why, and the judicial philosophy they have is one of the reasons why I believe President Trump won the election over Hillary Clinton, because people understood, based on a list that the president made public before he was elected, the type of people he would be looking to fill these judicial vacancies. Judges who would faithfully interpret the Constitution and will say what the law is, not what their personal policy preferences might be or what they wish the law to be. That's our job, and that's the reason we run for election, the political branches of government, the executive and the legislative branch. Judges were, in the words of Alexander Hamilton in the Federalist Papers, called the least dangerous branch. And by that, he meant that their job was to literally call, or figuratively, I should say, call balls and strikes. In other words, they were not seen as policymakers, or else we never would have given them, or they never would have given judges lifetime tenure, so they are insulated from politics. So it is precisely because they are insulated from politics that they should perform the critical but limited role of interpreting the Constitution and laws as written. Of course, the most notable example of a judicial confirmation we've had during the last year and a half was the confirmation of Neil Gorsuch to fill the seat left by Justice Scalia. But now, on September the 4th, Chairman Grassley on the Judiciary Committee has announced we will begin the hearings on the nomination of Brett Kavanaugh to succeed Justice Anthony Kennedy on the Supreme Court. But it's not just the Supreme Court that's important, it's the courts below the Supreme Court that do the day-to-day work of the federal judiciary, including the 26 appellate judges that I mentioned earlier that include Texans like Don Willett, Jim Ho, and Andy Oldham, all of whom will now or do now serve on the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. And of course, we should mention the very talented district court judges that we've confirmed as well, three of them from Texas, Karen Schooler, David Counts and Fernando Rodriguez are three of those talented district court judges that we have confirmed. Overall, Mr. President, we have confirmed more than 50 of President Trump's judicial nominations. Again, I believe one of the most important jobs we perform here in the United States Senate. But third on my list of accomplishments that I want to talk about today, I alluded to a moment ago when talking about the economy that's taken off. And that is one of the most important things we've done since have been here during the Trump administration is repealing overly burdensome Obama-era regulations through something called the Congressional Review Act. We've used this device 16 times to eliminate agency rules that were sometimes snuck in the waning hours of the Obama administration. On top of that, we repealed the Independent Payment Advisory Board, or IPAB, under Obamacare. This will allow senior citizens and their families to take better control and greater control of their own health care decisions without being subjected to the whims of unelected bureaucrats. And we made Obamacare voluntary by limiting the individual mandate, which was a tax on middle and low-income people who couldn't afford to purchase the Obamacare policies. Obamacare's main problem was that it represented perhaps the most intrusive government mandate into the lives of the American people by saying, you don't have any choices anymore when it comes to your health care. You must buy this government-approved health care policy. And oh, by the way, it doesn't make any difference if it has coverage that you don't want or can't afford. You've got to buy it, and if you don't buy it, we're going to fine you. Well, we've repealed that tax on low and middle income Americans, and we truly have made health care more available, really, by creating, allowing a market to be created where people have choices. Kudos to our Secretary of Labor, Secretary Acosta, who worked with the administration to provide more access to health care policies across state lines. And the administration, the Health and Human Services Secretary, recently announced that people can buy policies on an annual basis that are subject to renewal that provide them greater choice and flexibility. So this is part of creating a market which is the best regulator of all, as opposed to government. People wonder why conservatives believe that big government is a bad thing sometimes. And it's precisely because when government gets bigger, our freedoms shrink in proportion to that growth in the role of the federal government. So that's pretty important, repealing those regulations, eliminating the individual mandate. The fourth major accomplishment, I believe, is providing relief to America's community and mid-sized banks and credit unions, which have been hit hardest by some of the one-size-fits-all rulemaking approaches under the Dodd-Frank bill. Again, one of the problems about legislating and regulating here in Washington, D.C., is we live in a big and diverse country, and one-size-fits-all doesn't work. Or if it does, it often has collateral damage. And in this case, while we were aiming at the excesses of Wall Street, small banks and credit unions were the collateral damage. And what that meant is that consumers didn't get access to the credit they needed. Small businesses didn't get access to the loans that they needed in order to start a business or to grow a business. The next thing that I want to mention in terms of the accomplishments of the last year and a half have to do with our commitments to service members in our military, as well as veterans. We've restored America's defense with the greatest investment in the military in decades, including the largest troop pay raise in nearly 10 years. Now, if you think about all the things that the federal government does, not all of them are equal. Some are more important than others. And I would put at the top of the list providing for our common defense, because it is that defense of our freedom and our liberty and our way of life that makes possible all of the other things we enjoy, the blessings of liberty we enjoy as Americans. And so making sure that our military is properly funded and we take care of the troops that wear the uniform of the United States military is the most important job of the federal government. And then it's important to keep our commitment to our veterans when they take off that uniform. And we did that this year in passing the VA Mission Act, which makes significant reforms to the Department of Veterans Affairs, strengthening the health care and community care options that are available to America's veterans. We're all aware of some of the scandals in the VA system where veterans have had to travel hundreds of miles or wait months to get access to care. And we've addressed that by the VA Mission Act, which reinforces veterans' choice. In other words, if you'd rather go see a health care provider in your local community, if the wait is too long to be seen at a dedicated VA facility, or if you have to go too far to get to a VA facility, you can get access to a local health care provider in your community and the VA will pay for it. To me, that's a really important element of our veterans' health care system. Last but certainly not least is the sixth achievement of this last year and a half during the Trump administration and Republican majorities in both houses. We've taken steps to rebuild and protect our local communities. We passed nearly $147 billion in disaster relief for storms like Hurricane Harvey, which devastated Texas 1 year ago this month. On top of that, we've enacted the Stop Enabling Sex Trafficking Act, which provided resources to fight the rape kit backlog and improve school safety by a bill that I sponsored called Fix NICS to make sure that people who are illegally disqualified from purchasing or possessing firearms are prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law and prevented, if possible, from getting access to those firearms. So, Mr. President, these are just a handful of ways we are doing what we told the American people we would do if they would entrust us with the great privilege of being stewards of that public trust. We put money back in Americans' pockets. We've rolled back regulations that have made their lives easier. We strengthened the military. We've given health care flexibility to our veterans, and we've protected our communities from harm. But of course, there's more work that needs to be done. Just before the state work period just concluded this last week, the Senate voted to proceed to a conference on the Farm Bill. This bill is of great importance to the people of my state. City dwellers may not fully appreciate it, but according to the 2012 census, agriculture employs one out of every seven working Texans. With 28 million Texans, that's a huge number of farmers and ranchers directly affected by what we do in the Farm Bill. What people don't realize, however, is that nutrition programs, not agriculture funding, account for almost 80% of the cost of the Farm Bill. This includes the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, formerly known as food stamps. So although I was proud to support the Senate's version of the legislation, I was somewhat disappointed that it did not include stronger reforms to some of these nutrition programs, including work requirements for people who are able-bodied, or training requirements for people who need additional training, or community service for people who can't work or don't want the training, but at least provide some service to their local communities. And I appreciate what the House has done to provide for those work requirements in the bill that my friend Chairman Conway included in the House version. These reforms are not last-minute additions. There was a long, thorough process leading to the introduction of the House Farm Bill. Chairman Conway held more than 20 hearings on these nutrition programs, including some during the Congress, and afterwards he put together some very common sense work requirements that were based on broad stakeholder input. During this record of low unemployment across the nation, it's not unreasonable to try to use this opportunity, which comes only once every 5 years, to take a look and ensure that our federal dollars are being spent wisely and that able-bodied adults are getting the training they need in order to earn good pay, and that federal assistance is only used to provide for those who are unable to provide for themselves. A scholar from the American Enterprise Institute, Michael Strain, wrote about this recently. He wrote that the question of whether there should be mandatory work component in public policies designed to assist low-income households is part of a question of economics, but it's also moral and philosophical as well. Whom should we expect to work in our society? Should a healthy person in the prime of their life who doesn't have young children at home be working, yes or no? In other words, does that person owe some share of his or her energy, ability, and intelligence to the rest of society from which we all benefit, including them? Some think that it's nobody's business but the individuals, whether they work or not, and still receive these benefits. But I disagree with that. When the question involves federal benefits that are paid for by all taxpayers, whether to work or not is no longer just a private, personal decision. We as a country have decided that part of our social contract with each other will be providing a safety net where needed, and that's important. But the flip side is that to benefit from that safety net, there also ought to be certain obligations. In other words, you can't have rights without responsibilities. And one of them should be to work if you're able to do so. So while I wish the members of the conference committee my best as they try to reach consensus on the Farm Bill, I would encourage them to take another look at Chairman Conway's ideas on work requirements. I hope my colleagues will be willing to revisit this issue in the Conference Committee on the Farm Bill. Mr. President, I yield the floor.